It's March 28th, 1995. It's a brisk 47 degrees outside. Tom Hanks just won an Academy Award for his role in Forrest Gump, and the Knicks are preparing to play the Chicago Bulls. Patrick Ewing is on a tear, coming off of a month where he averaged 28 and 12 a game as a top candidate in the MVP race. Meanwhile, the Bulls are well on their way to finishing with their worst record in nearly a decade. They're hardly a 500 team. They're struggling. Well, at least they were, until...
There'll be no Beatles reunion. Elvis is still dead. But Michael Jordan is back.
Jordan is back on the court, and the fans are going mad on Madison.
If he wanted to come back to the NBA, he could come back in a second and be one of the best players in the league.
I'm back.
Average almost seven block shots a game. Oh, great look. Hook up to Jordan
next year. Let's just hope they listen. Michael Jordan gets the buzzer.
Michael, you got it, baby. Coaster. Yes.
Look out. Three on one.
Michael Jordan made his return to basketball just 10 days ago, and although a bit rusty, he's the most dominant force on the court. At the time, this March matchup was nothing more than an ordinary game between two rival teams. But inevitably, it would become the game that nearly changed the league forever. As the game gets underway, both teams come out firing, going blow for blow. The Knicks pull out to a 3-point lead at the end of the first and find themselves ahead by 6 at the half. Although the score is separated by just 6 points, the Knicks are looking like the better team, and for the first time in this heated rivalry, they feel like they can make a statement against Michael and his Bulls. This was their chance to show that they were finally ready to transcend this Bulls squad. The same Chicago Bulls that knocked them out of the playoffs 4 out of the last 6 seasons. And this might have been possible if Jordan wasn't playing absolutely out of his mind.
Yeah, the thinking there is that if you miss, Jordan operating, fell down, got rid of it to Pippen, back to Jordan. Down 80-79, 30 seconds, a three-pointer, 18 for 32. Isolated against Starks, carrying 5 fouls, Jordan from 16. There's the... Jordan with 53.
After dropping 35 points in the first half, Jordan comes out in the third quarter ready to put the Knicks to bed. John Starks, on the other hand, would rather be anywhere in the world except right here, getting abused by MJ. After battling for 47 minutes in a game that would go down as an all-time regular season classic, the game is tied with just 39 seconds left in the fourth. The Bulls put the ball in Jordan's hands and let him go to work. MJ goes left, then pushes right. Hesitates, pump fakes, and gets Starks in the air. Then, in true Jordan fashion, sinks the jumper. Bulls by 2. John Starks comes back and draws a foul with just 14.6 seconds left on the clock, and sinks 2 clutch free throws. Tie game.
Goat mode activated.
Omae wa mou shindeiru.
Nani?
With less than 15 seconds left on the clock, Jordan has to make something happen. He pushes the ball up the court. With just 8 seconds left in the game, Jordan comes down and hits Starks with the crossover so mean that for a brief moment, John Starks actually forgot how to walk. Gathering himself from his puddle of misery, Starks tries to recover, but it's too late. The only thing between Michael and the basket is Patrick Ewing. Jordan spins, rises, and shoots the
gotcha, bitch!
Jordan fakes the shot and zips a pass to Bill Wennington underneath the basket. Now, Bill, good old Bill, was set up to put this epic thriller in the books. This was his time to shine. In fact, it was his only time to shine, since aside from the 3 personal fouls he had racked up in this game, Bill had not produced a single stat all night. Up until this moment, Bill Wennington had done absolutely nothing all game. But that didn't stop him from balling the f*** out for 1.1 seconds.
Michael finds the open man. Wennington with a jam. 3.1 remaining. Timeout, New York. That was outstanding.
Truly a basketball god. But there's still time on the clock, so with 3.1 seconds left, the Knicks inbound the ball to Starks. Now is his chance to get Jordan back. to stand his ground and prove that the East now belonged to the Knicks.
Darnton right here. Here's Starks. He falls down, loses the ball over the backcourt. Backcourt violation. Chicago 10th ball. Of a second left.
That delay of game was brilliantly executed.
Well, yeah, because everyone in this league.
Starks, while simultaneously sh**ing his pants, loses the ball, goes back court, commits a turnover, and then puts up a backward 60-foot heave. Pat Riley is sick. Once again, MJ seals the deal in heroic fashion. Needless to say, for the next three seasons, he went on to rewrite record books and cement his legacy in history. But all of this nearly didn't happen. In fact, for a split second, the entire landscape of basketball could have been changed forever. During the second quarter of that March matchup, with 25 seconds left on the clock, Jordan drove the ball to the hoop and was caught in an awkward mix-up with Patrick Ewing. And that is when this happened.
They're being really exposed here against the New York Knicks tonight. Five to shoot. Jordan.
Yes.
He's fouled hard by Patrick Ewing.
See, he elevated for the dunk that time. He was going dunk all the way. He fooled Starks. Starks thought that he was going to the middle, and he just took it right to the baseline. Went for the elevate. Now, just keep an eye on this. He has him beat. Now, watch what happens. He's going dunk all the way here. But then you have the shot. Keep an eye to the left. Now, watch Patrick come in here. Former teammates on the Dream.
Now, at first glance, this looks pretty bad, but when you watch it a second time, it's even worse. How MJ somehow managed to walk away from this with absolutely no injury is beyond me. His right foot is completely contorted, and his leg falls underneath him as the entire weight of his body comes down on it. Not only that, he also hits his head on the way down. This could have, and probably should have, been a catastrophic injury. We've seen players land like this before. Two seasons ago, Gordon Hayward got caught up in a similar fashion and ended up with a terrible injury that sidelined him for the entire season. Back in 2007, Sean Livingston came down at an awkward angle and it resulted in arguably the worst injury in modern basketball. Same goes for Klay Thompson, who is still sidelined because of an awkward landing in last season's finals. Not only did these falls sideline players for an entire season, with injuries like this, players never truly recover 100%. Whether it's a loss of explosiveness, a hitch in their step, or just a mental barrier lingering from the most traumatic moment in their sports career. If injuries as severe as these don't ruin a player completely, it certainly hinders their game for the rest of their days on the court. Luckily, that night, the basketball gods spared Jordan. But what if things were different? What if this fall resulted in an injury that took Michael Jordan out of the game for good? We would have never got the chance to witness this, or this, or this. In fact, a league without Jordan is an interesting one. Because although he only went on to play three more seasons with the Bulls and two more ill-advised seasons with the Wizards, his impact was monumental. Over the next three seasons, the Chicago Bulls bullied their way through the entire NBA and three-peated for the second time in a decade. But in this alternative timeline, without the help of the best player to ever lace up, that never happens. Instead, in 1996, the Orlando Magic or the Seattle Supersonics come out on top. It's hard to say which team would have won the championship in this hypothetical finals matchup, but either way, it's not the Bulls. In 1997, without MJ or the Bulls as the clear favorites, it's almost certain that the Utah Jazz pull ahead as the most dominant team in the league and beat the Miami Heat for their first championship in franchise history. And again, in 1998, the Jazz come out on top and win back-to-back titles as they beat the Pacers, who made it out of the East instead of the Bulls. In this Jordan-less league, not only do the odds favor heavily with two franchises who have never won a title, no matter which way you spin it, numerous NBA legends who never won a ring get their hands on a title this time around. Karl Malone, John Stockton, Penny Hardaway, Sean Kemp, Reggie Miller, Chris Mullin, Tim Hardaway, among many others, are all NBA greats that got shut down during Jordan's reign, but without him around would have a shot at basketball immortality. If we take a look at Jordan's current career statistics compared to what his numbers would be if he never touched the court again after that game in March of 95, immediately we see a tale of two different legacies. One being the current MJ that for the vast majority of us is the undisputed GOAT. 6-0 in the finals and a laundry list of NBA records and moments that have been cemented in time. Then, there's the what if Michael Jordan. The one with absolutely ridiculous numbers. The MJ that never saw a season that wasn't in his prime. The MJ that had the world saying, what if he didn't get hurt in 95? If Michael Jordan never played another game after his fall, would he still widely be considered as the best player of all time? Or would another star rise to the top and rewrite history in his favor? Well, a league without Michael Jordan also means a league where the Bulls never went 72-10 in 1996, erasing that dominant season from the record books. And without MJ running a monopoly on the league, David Robinson wins league MVP in 1996, winning it in back-to-back seasons. And Karl Malone wins the award in 1998, being only the fourth player in league history to win three regular season MVPs in a row. In fact, if this moment ends tragically, Karl Malone more than likely ends his career with two championships, possibly two finals MVPs, and three regular season MVPs to go along with his other NBA records and accolades. That's a resume that would put him right in the middle of the GOAT discussion. But as dramatic as these changes are, Jordan's absence would have a much deeper ripple effect. In fact, in this moment, the birth of an entirely different NBA takes shape. See, in 1996, the Bulls won 72 games, so they got the last pick in the first round of that year's draft, which they used to pick Travis Knight. Knight played 7 NBA seasons and averaged just 3 points per game, which, as disappointing as that sounds, it's virtually irrelevant since the Bulls saw so little promise in the kid that they renounced their rights to sign him and he ended up playing for the Lakers instead. Well, in 1996, Michael Jordan had a win share of 20.4, meaning according to advanced metrics, Jordan contributed over 20 wins to the Bulls that season. Of course, this is anecdotal, and Jordan's contributions can't be measured in sheer numbers, but if we can put our disbelief to the side for just a moment, this means that with Jordan now gone, the Bulls would have won about 52 games that season instead of 72. Well, that season, the Pacers ended up with 52 wins as well, maneuvering their way to the rights to the 10th pick in the first round of the draft through a trade with the Denver Nuggets. With MJ now sidelined for the foreseeable future, the Pacers' path to a championship is now wide open, so this time around they keep their core together instead of trading those key pieces, the same core that got them to the Eastern Conference Finals in the previous season, the only team standing in their way being the Orlando Magic. On the other hand, the Bulls know that without MJ, they aren't the perennial threat they once were, and they're now desperate to get their hands on some talent. Talent that can score the ball and fill the immense hole where Jordan used to be. So this time around, instead of the Pacers, it is now the Bulls who acquire the 10th pick in the draft. In 1996, the Pacers selected 7-foot center Eric Dampier with this pick. But the Bulls don't need a center. They need a shooting guard. So they turn their eyes to the next best prospect at that position. A prospect that reminds the Bulls of their fallen superstar. A prospect that would go down as one of the best players of all time.
With the 10th pick in the 1996 NBA draft,
the Chicago Bulls select
Kobe Bryant from Lower Merion High School in Pennsylvania.
Kobe's having a spectacular year, as always.
One, Kobe. Oh, past the foul, slam dunk. Great fast break. The Black Mamba strikes again.
That's right. On March 28th, 1995, Michael Jordan nearly fell victim to a catastrophic injury that would have forced him to retire, helped the Jazz establish themselves as the best team in the league, would have propelled Karl Malone into GOAT status, and would have made a 17-year-old Kobe Bryant the predecessor to the suddenly injured Michael Jordan. Is this one of the most overlooked moments in NBA history? Yes. Am I reaching with some of these assumptions? Absolutely. Every game, every player, every moment has an endless array of possibilities that could have resulted in an NBA far different than the one we see today. But this is my video, and I have a lot of time on my hands. And when you come across a clip like this, you can't help but to wonder what could have been. But in this moment, the basketball gods chose to spare Michael Jordan from what could have been an injury that would have changed the game to this very day. Hope you all enjoyed, and as always, until next time.